Hi, and welcome back. In case you're new to the channel, this channel is all about orchestral composition and cinematic music production. Look, I cannot procrastinate this any longer. You've requested several times a mix video or a video where I go through my mixing process. And I'm really scared. I'm genuinely scared of today's video because that's the process that I feel least comfortable about. And I get the feeling that you, my viewers, you are in the exact same position where you say, that's an uncomfortable step. Coming up with a mix is hard. And you know what? It is. And most likely, I have no secret sauce for you to teach. I know there are lots of YouTube videos out there saying this is ruining your mix or you must do this to get the perfect mix and I don't know what. And you know what? They're all just clickbait because it's a real craft. Mixing is hard and it needs to be practiced and it needs to be practiced a lot and I'm not really good at it. I would say I'm fair to the point where I'm able to produce some kind of final result of my music mixed and mastered in my gentle little home studio that I'm sitting in, that is good enough for my purposes. But if I ever wanted any of my tracks properly produced, I would always hand it off to a professional mix engineer because those guys know what they're doing and they do it much better than I do. But with all these warning messages being said, and you still watching, I say, we let the jingle roll. Then I see you over there in the door and I take you with me on the journey, step by step, to take a full piece and mix it and master it and render it out and enjoy it. So, see you over there. Okie dokie. So I'm trying to get the mix already right before I go to the mixing stage. So this is, let's say, an approximation using whatever the VST instruments give me. And, you know, just a rough, the guitar is like way too loud. I guess Native Instruments just likes recording stuff very upfront so that, you know, so I toned it down a bit. And then this Musio Harp sound apparently was a bit soft, so I turned it louder. So that's the kind of stuff that I'm doing, but primarily I'm trying to use expression and modulation. Now, before I export all of the stems, let's listen to this all back end to end so that you know what the piece is all about, the finished piece. Thank you. is time. It is time now to figure out who is going to get a track of its own right and who's going to be bundled together to make the mixing process actually something that I can handle. So, first things first. I believe that a bass drum needs to have its own thing. So the way I do this is I put an ST in front of the track, which tells me this is a stem. This is going to be a stem. I feel that the bass drum and the snare are so important that I'm going to keep them as single stems. Okay, triangle, piatti, tuba de bells, glockenspiel, clickatoi, cinematic percussion, gong, and all of this goes, I would say, to a bass, and that's the stem percussions high. So let's put this, all of the longs, legato long, legato long, legato. So this is gonna be my this is gonna be my stem strings long, and then I'm gonna take the shorts, violin one, violin two, viola and cello, and I'm gonna create a stem strings short. What I'm going to do right now is I'm going to export stems. And usually what I do is I just export all of the, everything. And between the song start and end marker, 2 minutes and 40 seconds. Now, next thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to create a new project. Wild West Mix Project. Not even sure about that. Never mind. I like the idea that it's a Wild West music, so let's go for that. And it's my mix project. And I start nice and empty. Let's open the stems and let's order them by name. And you see I've exported everything. But I'm only now going to take all of those marked with ST. Which are those? Just drag and drop them over here. Bajing. Excellent. Next thing I do is I color everything in my beloved color code. So I'm going to make strings green, brass, I'm going to make orangey yellow, so this is trumpets, and I'm going to order everything in a way that makes sense for me, whatever that means. This is the structure of all of my stems. So I have, percussions up here, and if we play this back and we have a look at our mix console, it should be all fair. So, and you can already hear that this sounds a lot worse than the mix before. One of the reasons is being, for instance, the English horn is very dry, right? So one of the things that I'm definitely gonna need is my, that's a default that I always have, is my stage reverb. So I'm gonna add a bus channel. It's gonna pop up over here and this is gonna be my stage reverb. And the stage reverb is my impulse response reverb. In case you don't know, there's like two different types of reverb. There's algorithmic reverb, and where basically the reverb tail is computed. My favorite one for that is Raum, because it's easy to use. Basically, I'm always, you know, trying to find things that are easy to use for me. And here, this one is just the built-in Studio One one, which is open air. And I like to go to rooms and to large rooms. I've spent an evening and more than one trying to find like what's the one that I like the most, and this one I like. Okay, and now what I'm doing is I'm going to mono and reviewing the levels of everything. So that's kind of, you know, trying to work from the most important to the least important. The trick to go for levels is do it in mono, like so your ears won't trick you, because if you have the full stereo spectrum, sometimes you hear instruments more clearly than they are or less clearly than they are. And if you go to mono, you get a bit more of a truth. I'm not suggesting that you should only mix in mono. What I'm suggesting is that before you go to the finer refinements, you should get your bass levels straight. And we should be really, really close to that already. So, okay, I think I've got the levels now fairly right. So I toned down the trombones quite a bit, the low brass a little bit. At some points I felt very tempted to make things louder, but I'm not doing that because the next step is now adding reverb and then fine tuning. So let's try. So the first thing I think is the bass drum I toned down quite a bit. Feel the bass drum is quite punchy, so I might want to, or boomy, let's say, so I might want to cut down frequencies over here. You can hear it's a little bit less boomy on the stage reverb. Ladies and gentlemen, one thing I always like to do is just cut down all of the low, because no one's going to need that, and the very, very high ones as well. See? Like to put at least a little bit of compression on here, and because it's a bass drum, compression I always like to use supercharger. I'm gonna give it also a little bit of the fat thing, which is gonna make it fatter, and we're gonna give it a bit punch and no saturation. I don't think we need saturation, but let's see what this does with your overall mix. So look, the struggle is real, but so is the fun. So if there's anything interesting here, and if watching me walk you through my mixing process, something that's useful for you, you know, just to get more ideas, well, here I am, and I'm sharing this with you, although I'm feeling very uncomfortable and insecure about it. So if you want to encourage me to do more things that I feel insecure, but I'm still, you know, taking you with me on the journey, smash the like button and let me know that you get something out of this video. Would be amazingly great. Thanks. Let's keep doing this. Percussion's high, very likely gonna cut out a lot of this stuff. And give it a bit of fresh air. So fresh air is another way of compression, but I think I have it here on the clarity. There we go. It's a free plugin and gives a lot of presence in the mid and high frequencies, which is basically one of the main purposes of the high percussion. But use with caution, because it can get out of hand quite quickly. Like, listen to this. You heard like a click there, right? So this is much more likely what we'd rather want. It's too much higher. What I'm going to try to do is again compress this, but in a much more gentle way. So with gentle compression, it's going to give it a bit of a bright character and a bit of a gentle compression. Don't need saturation here, I'm pretty sure about that. It's already very high frequency, very distorted. Strings! So here's one of the things. Strings have a very hard time competing against brass and percussions and all these kind of things. So one of the things that I like to do with strings is to stereo widen the overall signal that I have. And I use this one. It was cheap. You probably have a stereo widening tool in your toolbox anyway, but look, what this does is it helps me put the violins, the violas, and the celli a little bit further outside. I don't want to do that with the double basses, which is one of the reasons why double basses are extra and never part of my strings bus, if that makes sense. Sometimes I put the celli also its own thing. All good, all fine. There's different ways to do that. There's no right or wrong way. But what I like to do is I like to stereo widen this because it will help me not have to, you know, make the strings super loud to be heard. Okay, another thing that I like to do, that sounds already pretty good, so I'm gonna copy this setting over to the long strings and also copy the stretch reverb settings to the long strings, right? So now this should be somewhat consistent. See, it's kind of, you know, because it would be weird if first the stereo image would be close and then it gets wider. But, you know, I know I'm using the same mic positions, the same instruments, the same library. So this should work and give me a rather consistent sound, which it does. It does. Good. Before I move to the basses, I still want to do one thing with that, and that is on the compression. And I have a tape. I think I put it under distortion, I guess. I have a tape emulation. It's a super subtle effect. I like doing it. It gives me a little bit of clarity and it compresses the sound a little bit and distorts it a little bit. Gives it a little bit more of an analog flair. Okay, double basses, reverb, danger zone, danger zone. Reverb on double basses, danger zone. But I do have a nice little effect that I like using. Let's add it as an effects channel, and that's max bass. This is max bass. Okay. That's another plugin from Waves Audio. A little max bass stereo. And what it does is it takes an original bass signal, here you have it, and then you can tune in a, let's say, harmonic of that. So it's going to try to kind of create harmonics to the original fundamental of the bass. And then I cut this out here, and one thing more which I like to do, which I have no idea why that's the case, but it is, if I go to the input controls and I go to this channel and to the max bass channel and I invert the phase. No clue why that's the case, but it will make the effect sound much beefier. So. The English horn. So this guy needs a lot of presence. It's already sent to the stage reverb. Presence means usually compression, and it's a supercharger GT type of compression that I want to use. I'm going to give it a bright character. Let's see what this does. Now we need to take care of the muted trumpet because that's a lead instrument. It needs to be like super clearly hearable. So let's give it a bit of saturation. Let's give it a gentle and let's give it a bright character over here. Let's listen to that. So next step, now that I have a roughly working mix, roughly. Okay, now I'm going to go about volume automation. But look, volume automation is really useful when I'm introducing elements to make them a bit louder, put a little bit more front. I think this is a track that will not need a lot of volume automation, but let's listen to it. And now it's about time to go like, oh, critical thinking or critical listening. Very hard on my own piece, gonna be honest, but let's see. So I'm gonna run once through, try to program all the volume automation that I think is necessary, and then we're gonna come back. Oh, by the way, I do other videos with much more self-esteem on my YouTube channel, doing reviews of libraries, but also composition techniques, orchestration techniques, and just taking you along with my creation journey. So if you enjoy this type of content, it would be great if you would subscribe to the channel, like so you won't miss out on any future content. And now, let's cross the finish line. I'm done automating, I believe at least. Probably if I come back tomorrow, I'll say, damn, I need to change a lot of things. Okay, but that's just, you know, that's a normal thing. Okay, so where did I automate? I automated the string longs over here, particularly for the opening run into this here, because I wanted to have a stronger effect. So there we go with this part. I wanted to bring this to the attention of the listener, and here where the strings are playing tremolando, I actually increased the volume a little bit because it were a bit soft. Other than that, I didn't touch the longs, I didn't touch the shorts, I touched the basses a lot because there were inconsistencies in the sound of the pizzicatos. The woodwinds I had to massage quite a bit to bring them a little bit to the front, particularly in the beginning because the sound was a bit thin, so just listen to that. You know, I do this. This is kind of a dear listener's brain. There were oboes playing a texture. Please pay attention, which is why I bring the volume to the front and then the listener gets aww. And in the second, third and so forth, I don't need to do that anymore. Here we have a little run, which I wanted to emphasize. And here, let's see what is here on the woodwinds. That's again, it's the same issue where I go like, dear listener's brain, there's a doo-dee-doo-dee going on. Second time, I'm not emphasizing it. And the third time, I think what I'm emphasizing here is the flute. So that's the kind of tweaking that I do. It's small emphasis on like, hey brain, listen what's here, and then it's easier to follow along what's going on. The muted trumpet I turned a bit louder. That's the heroic trumpets. Oh yeah, there was a little bit of interaction between the trumpets and the horns, where here I needed the horns to stand a little bit more to the front. So it's a similar thing. We have a second trumpets are playing the main line here. That's going to be fair and loud enough. But then the horns kick in. And at the beginning, they're a bit soft, and that's okay for me. But then I want to put them like to the forefront and then bring them back again so that, you know, the listener gets it. There's that going on. That's cool, you know? And now I make the trumpets a bit louder because they, you know, right after the horns get their shiny moment, the trumpets come again a little bit more to the forefront, making the mix a little bit more balanced. Now it comes a matter of experience because the final touch that I do is mastering. And since I'm absolutely incompetent for mastering, I'm sorry to say that, but I'm completely incompetent for mastering, At some point in time, I invested the, I think it was like $100 or so to get a proper, I'm not sure, it wasn't a sale. I didn't get it for the full price. But I spent a lot of money, that's what I'm trying to tell you, to have an AI do that for me, because I think it's going to get a better result than I do. I just go in here. I play my audio. It's me from tomorrow, or next day me. I guess you can call it the way you want. And look, the reason why I need to talk to you is because I did what I always do with my mixes, which is I went to bed yesterday evening quite late, very tired, and with ears completely worn out from the process of mixing and figuring out levels and I don't know what. And usually when I wake up next day, what I do is I smash in my consumer headphones and I listen to it and I go like, oh, it's that and that and that and that and that, and I don't want to change that. And the next thing I do is I go to my car and I listen to all of the mix in my car. Because why? Because my consumer headphones, which I listen, are, you know, that's a system I'm listening all the time music for. So I know what music is supposed to sound like when it's sounding really good. And my car, because it's a challenging situation, so there's a lot of rumbling going on when driving on the streets and so forth. And again, I know exactly how I like to listen to music and what's the result that I'm expecting. So I came back to the drawing table, or let's say to my door, right over here, and I started changing things, particularly almost only volume stuff, with one exception that I'm going to talk to you about right now, which is something I was a bit unhappy with in the mix that I created yesterday. But the thing is, that's how the process works, at least for me. I haven't found a way to spend 2 or 3 hours mixing and then go, done, and publish it. I always have this step in between of, you know, bouncing it out and then sleeping, letting my ears relax, come back to this thing the next day and then go like, how did I not hear that yesterday? And then I go like, yes, because I was working and I was tired already. So let's fix it right now. The main thing that bothered me is, and I wasn't used to that, so the max bass effect, it's the first time that I'm trying to properly mix a project where I'm using Jaeger basses, so from the Jaeger library, and you know, you need to get to know your library. So one of the things I did with max bass is I toned it down quite a bit because it was, it had some annoying resonances, particularly when listening back in the car. I split up this part at the very beginning into a separate track, which I called Basses 2, and I left everything almost the same, except I removed this dip, which was cancelling out a little bit too much the cello, because what this is this is this, it's called low strings patch, which is actually a pre-orchestrated patch of octaves of basses and strings in Jaeger, and basses and strings. Can't talk anymore. Basses and celli in octaves. And basically what happened is that this particular EQ was cutting down on the fundamental of the celli, which is why it sounded thin. So I moved it to a separate track and I removed the EQ. And everything else, I left the same, but I also removed max bass. Why? Because max bass, what it does is it tries to create harmonics of the fundamental of the real, you know, the boomy bass, so that it's heard also on cheap speakers. That's essentially what max bass does. And I don't need that if I have the celli already playing in octaves. So now this is what it sounds like. Let's compare it. You see how if I put it up there on a track with backspace and with EQ, it loses bite, grittiness, let's say, and becomes a lot, like, way too boomy. Enough of me babbling around. Let's listen to the whole thing and let's enjoy music that, by now, by the way, has a title and is not only called Wild West. Oh, that's the name. Dusty Trails and Distant Hearts. Let's go. Dusty Trails and Distant Hearts. Yeah, I'm sorry, I got really excited there, but hey, now I think I have a result that I'm good with. So this is going straight to Spotify. I'm like gonna publish this. Oh, by the way, if you don't know about that, you can find me on Spotify. I'm there with my clear name, Spotify title, Amazon Music, whatever, and you'll find like weird old stuff that I did before I really found my love for orchestral composition. And yeah, let's stop bubbling around. Let me know what you think and keep creating and see you around next week, where I'm gonna break down my latest piece that I uploaded just a few days ago to my channel, which is called, the working title was Sacrifice for a Soul. I think I opted in the end for a different title. The Sentient Sonata, which is not a sonata by any means of musical theory, but I like the title, so I went for that. If you haven't watched that, it's somewhere linked up there. And now, good for today. See you next week. Keep creating.